So good morning everyone. So we are going to start with our next chapter, that is your chapter number 4, and which is of part unit 2, which says thinking of prototyping. So whenever we talk about prototyping in this chapter, we are going to understand what do you mean by prototyping, how do prototyping takes place, what are the factors we really need to consider when we are thinking of prototyping. So this chapter basically becomes, and you can say, basic chapter for all other coming chapters ahead, because once you understand this chapter, that what do you mean by prototyping, then you can easily understand what do you mean by prototyping of your embedded devices, which is the next chapter. And the next chapter after this, that is your unit 3, chapter numbers 7, is prototyping online devices or online components. So this chapter becomes a baseline to understand what is prototyping. Once this is in place, you can understand the other two very fast. So in this chapter, we are seeing like what do you mean by prototyping, how the prototyping takes place, what are the different problems which comes when you are designing your prototyping, whenever you are going for a cloud, what are the different options which are available for you, what are the different types of source system, why you have to opt for this as particularly, why you have to opt that for as particularly, that is your closed and open. Then we have studied what is mixing of your open and closed, then how you're going to go for the closed sources for mass market projects, and the last is tapping into community. So let us start. So whenever we talk about prototyping, basically we refer it as making a small working model of your actual project, to be very simple. So prototype, in other words, you can say it is your early model, or you can say early release of your product. So whenever you want to build your product, or whenever you want to build your concept, you can say at a lower level, to understand what actually you're going to design at the bigger level, then we do a prototyping. Because obviously we don't directly start working with the actual model. First, we develop a small prototype which tells you whether whatever you are designing will have some feasibility or not. Whatever you are designing will have some functionality into it. What are the problems which you're going to face, or whether it is acceptable by the society or not. That is also very much important, because we are designing for people, not for ourselves. So with the prototyping, you can understand the problems or the solutions as well, that what you need to take care of. So whenever we talk about IoT prototyping, we are going to deal with the physical thing, because the definition says thing refers to object. And we talk about object, the object is nothing but the physical entities that are augmented with your sensors, your actuators. So we are going to deal with all the physical things. So we are actually designing your smart things, as IoT always refers to smart words. So we are designing the things which are very smart. And we are also designing the smart things along with the internet services which they will connect with, and they are going to give us those services. So when I talk about IoT prototyping, it can simply start with your microcontroller, or it can simply start with your breadboard, which you can see over your screens. There will be some wires which will be connected to it, and you will come up with some prototypes. You will have some actuators, you will have some sensors over it, and you will come up with your product. Always you have to remember one thing, that whenever you are designing your prototype, it should be a complete working project. Okay, though it is a very small prototype, that's all fine, but it should be a complete project, so that you can demonstrate it to the people, take more ideas from it, and you can explore your prototyping model at a higher level. So that was your prototype or prototyping. Next was your sketching. Whenever you start designing as a process, the very first initial step you have to do is you have to sketch your design somewhere. Because sketching actually helps us to convey our ideas. It helps to demonstrate our functionalities, how we want it to be. It actually tells us how is going to be the flow of your design. So sketches are very much important, because it is something that is going to connect to the user. The more simple is your sketch, or more simple is your user design, the more people will be attracted to it, isn't it? So you have to very much make sure that whenever you're starting with the sketching process, you have to design with an objective that you are designing for people. So it has to be very easy, it has to be very user friendly, and it has to be connecting. It should not be something like that you are using a dark colors. Even sketching can be in a form of drawing, as well as deciding the color also. So the sketching comes with everything. So when you are going thinking of sketching, you can simply go by jotting your ideas over a pen or paper, writing down whatever is coming into your mind, because at the first place you will have an initial design. Later on you will think more over it, you will explore more over it, and you will come with a perfect design which you want, that this is what I wanted. So you have to make sure that you make series of sketches, series of iterations of sketches will take place, and once you will decide that this is the one what I wanted, and you will go for it. So when I talk about sketching, it basically helps us to explore our problem spaces. Problem space refers to what are the problems that can be come. Okay, we have, it helps to understand our ideas, what actually is there into my mind. You're putting all your you can say your ideas, your thought processes from mind over your paper. Then you start again thinking over it, rethinking over it, and coming up with the actual sketching. So sketching is very much important whenever we talk about designing process, whenever we talk about development process, because it gives you can say input to your people or the end users who are going to interact with you. So your sketches is very much important. Next topic which we have is familiarity. So when I talk about familiarity, in a very simple words, familiarity refers to something you know before or something you have a good knowledge of. That is your familiarity. So familiarity here refers to what? Since you are working with IoT devices, okay, so IoT comes up with two devices or two, you can say, products. So that is your Arduino and Raspberry Pi. So whenever you are picking a platform, either it is Raspberry Pi or Arduino, you have to take care that you should be familiar with any of the language. So when I talk about any of the language, you refers to either you should be familiar with the hardware language, or either you should be familiar with the software language which is used to write the codes into the hardware. Like the example here is Raspberry Pi and Python. So my Raspberry Pi is nothing but a kit which is used for prototyping, and the programming language which is used to code a Raspberry Pi, which is used to write the codes into a Raspberry Pi, is Python. So you should be familiar with any of them. You should not go for any options like that wherein you are unknown with either the programming language which is used to write the code as well as the embedded platform which you are selecting. So you should have anything which you are known by you before only, so that you can easily understand and you can won't face problem. Because if you are not familiar with this, so later on when you talk about changing your embedded platform, the one reason of changing the embedded platform can be familiarity. Because you are not familiar, you are facing some problems and you are stuck somewhere. In contrast to this, you have your Arduino, which uses language like C, C++, and Java. So initially, if you want to understand, you want to have an understanding of your embedded kits, then you can go for the software versions which are available. Try to learn them, try to understand them. Python has been used only for the reason because it is very much clean language, you can say, and it is platform independent. So whatever you write in the Python, you don't need to understand them. Just it is a simple English syntax. So just by seeing them, you understand what that particular method is doing or what it is used for. So that is why they have used Python, because of it is platform independence and easability to understand. That is very much important. So familiarity here refers to you should be familiar with any of them. Either it should be your embedded platform or either it should be the programming language which you are using to write that embedded platform. So any of them should be there. So that is your familiarity. So initially, my suggestion is like you should not directly go with the actual working of the system. You should first have a prototype with help of the simulator, or you can say there are online tools available. First try to use them and then move to the actual product. And at least try to learn any of the language in case you are not knowing. The best possible solution can be you go for the software part, because the software part is very much important, because whatever codes you are going to write, accordingly that kit is going to respond you back. Okay, accordingly that embedded platform will respond you back. So here it is very much important that software language which you are using is very much important, and you should have at least familiarity with it. Next we had seen was cost versus ease of prototyping. So when I talk about cost versus ease of prototyping, the cost refers to your pricing. So whenever you're designing a prototype or whenever you're designing your actual system, the very first thing you need to consider the cost. Your cost will always be have relationship with your ease of prototyping, or it should always be balanced. It should not be something like that you are designing a product which is very costly and it is not ease to prototype. Ease to prototype here refers to what you can easily add, okay? You can easily remove. The prototyping design is very easy. People just by seeing them understand what it intends to do. So that is your ease of prototyping. So it should not be something like that, that the cost is big and the prototype design is also not connecting with the people because it is so difficult. Like we had seen affordances in the chapter one, which says what? Just by seeing it, you should understand the what operation it is going to perform. Similarly, when you are designing also, either it is a front-end design, either it is a back-end design, or altogether if it is one system of IoT, you have to take care of the designing part. You have to take care of how easy your systems are to interact with. Because to be very logical, the system more easy is it, the people are more connecting it. Now, if I talk about Android platform is so easy and everything is always same everywhere. So people are easily more connected to it. Okay, wherein if I talk about iOS, it is not that easy. People are not comfortable with it. Especially those who have a shift from Android to iOS, they will find a big difference. The reason is what? The reason is this, that one is very much user-friendly. The one is very easy. Like just by seeing it, you understand. Like if I move, click on this, this options will be there. Wherein in iOS, there is not simple readability. There are so many components and at times there are complicated as well. So it is very much important that your designing, your prototyping, your actual model should be very easy to understand. So whenever we are going for designing of your IoT project, you should always consider the platform which you are using, because the main cost which is related to the project is your platform. Depending on the platform, the cost will increase. Depending on the platform, the cost will decrease. So you have to select the platform accordingly with respect to cost. Important part when I talk about embedded devices is there should be good performance. If it has a good performance, then people will not hesitate to pay for the cost. So your performance has to be really good. And initially when you're going for a designing, the cost should not matter to you, because you will create your prototyping over, you can say, your simulations which is there, because you just want to have an understanding that whatever I'm doing will have a future or not. So whenever you are designing, initially you can make a prototyping over the simulation softwares which are available. Wherein if I talk about simulation with respect to your hardware devices, we have hardware simulations as well. Or in case if you are working on an actual physical model, then you can just take few of your breadboards, you can take few of the jumper wires and the sensors which are low cost sensors. You can just take them and create a prototyping. But important point is always, here, as I've always told you before, that when I talk about embedded platform, it comes with limited choices. Okay, so always to balance your choices with cost will not be possible. So you have to make a very good background study that whatever you want, is it there with respect to your cost? You have to start having a good background study of whatever you want. Along with the cost, you have to always take care of ease of prototyping. Your prototyping model should be very easy to use. It should be connecting. So that is also very much important. So if you are not having a good, hands-on or Raspberry Pi, then you can study Arduino first, because there is not much difference in Arduino and Raspberry Pi. It is just difference with respect to, you can say, storages, with respect to the USB slot. So there is not much difference. Actual working, which is required to understand any system, is common in both. So you can go Arduino, since C and C++ language is used there. And that is the language which every one of us must have used initially to start with software programming. So we know about it. So we can easily go with Arduino. Next bit we had seen was prototypes and production. So when I talk about prototypes and production, it refers to whenever you have designed your prototypes, how you are going to go for a production for those prototypes. So when we talk about IoT prototyping, it is not just simple prototyping, like wherein you will just have a one model and you will start creating the versions of that model. No, IoT is a bigger as a process. It is complete system. So here when I talk about prototyping, there are many things which are coming into the picture. It is your user interface. That is nothing but your smartphone app or web front end. Then we have an big hardware devices that is connected with your, you can say your breadboards, jumper wires. Then we have a backend and software that actually develops our business logic. So whenever we talk about IoT, we are integrating a hardware and a software together and making an IoT system. So when we talk about IoT prototyping, it is just a simple model. It is efforts of so many integrations, which is working as a one product. So it is basically integration of your hardware components along with the software components. And together they are making an IoT product. So whenever we are going for production, production means what? We are going for a mass bulk selling of your prototype. So whenever you are going for that, you have to make sure that whatever platform you are using, it should be very easy. Because if that is easy, you can create mass products very fast, or you can go for mass production very fast. If your technology which you are selecting or the platform which you are selecting itself is very much complicated, so it will take more time for you to go for production. You cannot produce faster. So technology, your platform plays a very important role whenever you are thinking for mass production. So initially, whatever is your one prototype which you have designed, which is successful, now you have to create thousands of them. Okay, so accordingly, you have to decide that whenever I'm designing a prototype with respect to IoT, some factors I really need to take care of. That will be my technology choices. That will be the platform which I'm looking for. Because it is not just software. For software to make or to go for a mass production is easy. But for a hardware and a software integration and together as a one product, in that case, it is very much difficult. So you have to make a very good choices. And you have to design in such a way that you are making a startup. It should be something in your mind like this, so that you can easily go for production and you can think that if I want to mass produce, will it be possible with this? If the answer is yes to this, then you can go for this model. Next topic is changing embedded platform. So whenever I talk about changing embedded platform, it refers to what are the reasons you encounter or you come across and decision you suddenly take that why or I want to change the embedded platform. So the reasons can be n number, okay? Because whenever you are designing your prototype, the actual problem comes there only. Initially, you think that I will try to manage it, I will do it. There are many positive thoughts which is there in our mind. But when we actually start working with the system, we start analyzing that, no, this is something which is not working out. I need to think over it. So that some point of time, you come with a decision like I need to change an embedded platform. And if you really think of changing the embedded platform, so we have limitations, we have less choices. So if you think of embedded platform, the other one is also going to be something like that. It is not going to be something really new for us. So instead of thinking of changing an embedded platform, the answer to this can be trying an alternative, trying the solution that if you are coming across this problem, then is there any alternative to solve it? Rather than changing a platform, you should find a solution to just solve that small problem. So when you talk about changing embedded platform, there can be various reasons depending on people to people who are actually designing a prototype over embedded platform. It can be the cost at times, because we are using electronics, we are using sensors, we are using actuators. So at time the cost becomes very high once by the time you just develop the prototype. Your prototype itself becomes so expensive that when you think it for mass production or when you think as a larger scale, you start realizing that it will be very costly. Second, at time there are size reasons. At times your prototyping design, either it becomes very big, which is not acceptable, or either it becomes very small, which is again not acceptable. Because when I talk about electronics, okay, they come with their form factors. You cannot tell that I want this form factor only and this is will be acceptable. So the size also becomes a very important factor when you think of changing your embedded platform. Another which the things which comes into the picture we have just seen now is your familiarity. At times you are not familiarity with your hardware platforms, nor you are familiar with your software programming languages which are used for writing them into the embedded devices. So that also becomes at times. So depending on the people, the reasons keeps on changing. But it is very much important that making the project 50% of it, or you can say just a 20% of it, and then you're making a choices, or when you're making a decision that I want to the embedded platform, is not the right choice. So it is very much important that if you're going for an embedded platform, have a good background study of it. Whatever you want, is it available at first place? What will be the cost? Try to take an estimation cost that if I'm designing a prototype, how much it is going to cost? Because that prototype is going to become exactly the actual system. Only the size will be different. It will maybe a big, maybe smaller. At times, when I talk about embedded platform, the size also can remain the same. You're just creating the same product at a, you can say, mass product. The same product is created at a higher level. So that is your changing embedded platform. So the solution here is don't go for completely changing the platform. Try to find alternative for it. Try to find solution for it. Now we have come up with so many solutions because embedded is now widely used by everyone. Initially, it was not used by many people, but now it is used by everyone. Once IoT has come into the picture, so you should think of it. Rather than changing a platform, try to find a solution for that component. Next we had seen was your climbing into the cloud. So whenever I talk about climbing into the cloud, it refers to storing your data over the cloud. As we know that in IoT, we are using sensors, we are using controllers, we are using actuators. So what happens there? There is a lot of real-time information being generated from these sensors. So we really need to store that data somewhere, as we cannot store physical storage mediums because your physical storage at some point of time is going to end because it is real-time information. Data will be incoming in seconds. Again, you will have. So there is lots of real-time information coming into it. So the suggestion for storing your real-time information is storing them into the clouds. As we have many options available now, there are many software companies who have come up with their software products wherein you can easily store your data into the clouds. The one of the most common one is your Microsoft Azure. Then we have Cisco IoT. Then we have AWS IoT. IBM have initially started with IoT platforms like storing your data into your clouds. So there is also something called as Google Cloud. So we have lots of options available to store the data into the cloud. So we have to consider any one of the option which we think it's feasible for us with respect to pricing as well. Okay, because the services are not free. You have to pay for them. So accordingly, you have to select initially few GBs they can allow you free. But later on, if you're going for an actual storage, then you have to pay for it. So that is your climbing into the cloud. Next we had seen was open source system versus closed source systems. So when we talk about open source system, the very first is definition. These source systems are freely available. The code is available on the internet. Anyone can delete it. Anyone can copy it. Anyone can modify it. Okay. So there is no owner involved into it. In contrast to this closed source, it is the closed source software system are copyrighted software system. They are proprietary. They are closely guarded with the code. So only the people, those who have designed this software or designed this source system are only allowed to view, update, copy the data and delete the data. Nobody else is allowed. Closed source are paid version. So you are purchasing the software as well as you are paying it. Wherein if I talk about open source, it is a free software. Next is distribution. Distribution here is open source is freely distributed. Closed source is not freely distributed because they are private company product. So it is copyrighted and their intention is to make money. So when the intention is to make money, they are not going to give any source code free. Third is your pricing. So when we talk about open source software, there is no pricing with respect to open source software. They are freely available. They are free of cost. However, if you want to provide any extra service, then in that case, the pricing can be there. Like if you're providing any additional services or you're trying to have some additional functionality, let us say if you want to have a security in your open source. So something if you are trying to add extra, that only will cost pricing. Otherwise, the code actual is free of cost. There is no pricing over it. So in contrast to this, when I talk about closed source system, these are the paid software. And depending on the selection of the software which you are making, the cost will keep on changing because they are the private companies. Okay, so their main intention is to make the money as well as their main intention is to give a better product and functionality with respect to innovations. Next, security. Open source doesn't comes with any security. The source code is readily available on a public platform. Anybody who want to have an access will have an access to that code. They will easily download the code. They will update the code. They will modify the code, and they will come up with multiple releases because there are different set of people working on the same code, or you can say a different code. So everyone have their ideas. They're adding their ideas to it and trying to create the release and coming up with innovations. So when I talk about closed source, the source code availability is not given to us because it is so much secured that the author itself or the designer who has designed the software has already set some norms. So because of that norms, you cannot break them. You cannot violate them. They are fixed. So you can't see the code. Okay, the code is not available to you. Only the components or the functionalities which are given to you by the company is only visible to you. You have to just use them. That's it. You cannot see the code. However, if anything goes wrong, if it is stuck somewhere, then in that case, you have to contact the company that is your support team member and accordingly solve your problem. Next is usability. So when we talk about usability of open source system, it is very easy to use because it is open source software. You can easily have an access to it. You can try your ideas. Even if your ideas fail, nobody is going to question you that why you have deleted this code. So there is no restriction over it. It is so easy to use. Okay, and the user guides which are written there is only for the community people. Nobody else can have an access to it or nobody else will understand because these are the community people. Now, when I talk about community people, it refers to what? The people, those who are belonging to the same community, like your software developers, your software testers. So these are the people who are actually working day and night in the code. So again, they are designing the, you can say the guides as per their form. So only those people who are belonging to that community can understand what the user guide is. However, when I talk about user guides in open source, it will not make any sense because it is not, you can say, following any standard norms. They are just designing like that for themselves and they are following it. It doesn't belong to any standard. However, when I talk about closed source system, the user guide is one of the most advantage, and that is advantage for all the private products or all the private companies who are making the software. The first place, their user guide is always very simple. You just by reading it, you understand what it is used for, how it is going to use. So the first place, the documentation part is always in place for the closed source or the softwares which are paid software. Because looking that or studying that, only the people are going to use the system. Because there is no prior training given to them. It is just a user guide, and reading that user guide, they have to operate the system. So it is very simple. Anybody who doesn't belong to the software background can also understand. Wherein if I talk about open source, the people, those who are belonging to the software background will only understand because they have designed in higher level language. They have designed as per their, you can say, needs or requirement, but it doesn't follow any norms. But in the closed source, it follows the norms. It always tells you ISO certified or which certification they have gone through. Okay. Last is your example, wherein if I talk about open source, the example will be your Android. Whenever I talk about closed source, the example will be your iOS. There are many other examples over the screen, Google Chrome, McAfee. So you can go with any options of your closed source and open source. Next topic is mixing your open and closed source. So whenever we have already started, like what do you mean by open source and closed source? So whenever you are thinking of mixing an open close, it is not a good option because one is completely open and another one is completely closed. So when you are mixing something like this, it is a very deadly combination. So you should not go for mixing the both because both are working independently. And more importantly, they are opposite of each other. So whenever you think of mixing, there has to be some commonalities between the two so that you can mix the sources. There is no commonality between the two. Both of them are very different from each other. So mixing of open and close cannot be a good option. Because you are trying to have a, like, there is like just when you talk about open and close, there is something like one to many relationship, as I've told you before, wherein there will be one thread and that will be controlled by many vulnerabilities. So that is a big problem because one is very much open and one is very much closed. One is sharing the entire information, which can actually help, can cause threats, and one is something which is very close, which can act as a vulnerability. So there is an opposite combination. So you should really not go for this. Either you should select one open as per your requirement, or either you should go for a close as per your requirement. So choice can be one at a time, not together. Next is closed source for mass market project. So we know what is a closed source. Closed source is something which is keeping their information confidential. They are more of security and reliability rather than open sources. So whenever this, you are always want to protect your sources, you want to always protect your code. In that case, if you go for a mass market, you will not be able to attract more customer, because when you talk about mass market production, people are something, they want a platform to be very much independent. They want some kind of freedom. The freedom will not be possible in closed source. However, if you're going for a private projects, or how we are going for the private softwares for mass market project, then it is fine. It is acceptable. But when you want to attract more customers, when you want to attract more people, so in that case, your product or your whatever source system which you are opting for should be very simple. It should be easy to communicate. People should get more freedom. So closed source for market project, like whenever we start with a project, so your project will not be successful initially, okay, but it will be very big. And if overall over it, if you're going for a closed source, then that you can say problem is just more, plus the problem increases as well. So in that case, whenever you're going for closed source for mass market project, you have to make sure that you are integrating with other company which can go for a good mass market, because you're not allowing the third party to have an access to your information. You are all the time securing your information. You are not showing your information to others, or you're not giving your information. So whenever you're going for a closed source, you are not giving an openness, you're not giving a freedom. So in that case, you should integrate with other big companies so that they can help you for the mass market. However, when we talk about open source, the mass market is always very clear for them. It is very easy for them, because they are not worrying about the source code. They know that the platform itself is a public. So if anybody will have an access to it, it is no harm to me. But in closed source, they are always trying to protect their source code. So whenever they are going for the mass market project, they are not providing you good options. They are not giving you more options. They are coming up with limited functionality. So whenever you're coming up with limited functionality, in that case, you have to make sure that you are tying up with some bigger companies and making your project sell. That can be the best idea. Next is the tapping into the community. So whenever we talk about tapping into the community, it refers to connecting with the community or having a talk with your community. Like whenever you are starting up with any project, or whenever you have start designing your prototype, once you have designed your prototype, now you want to take reviews from the people. So the very first place you're going to take the reviews from the people who are working in that background, so that you can get more insights of what you have designed, whether it is acceptable, whether it is feasible. Okay. However, there are many sources. You can go to Google search, but whenever you want to take a more knowledge about your technology, which you are selected, in that case, you have to refer, or you can say you have to contact to the community people only, those who are working into that platform since years and years, because other sources will give you just handful of information. But when I talk about the community people who are into this, you can say area since years and years, will give you more insights about it. They'll tell you more at deeper level what you should go for it. If something we have used which is outdated, they will give you an alternative, like go for this. This will give you more productivity. The performance will be high. So it is referring to your community people. It is referring to those set of people who will actually help you to give a valuable knowledge with respect to the product or a prototype which you are designing. At the other place, you can have some meetings also with the other set of people and take their inputs also, because once you have designed your prototype, you cannot come up with much options. So you want people inputs, because you are designing for people, not for yourself. So in that case, you have to keep asking about your prototype to each and everyone, take their feedbacks. But the very first place, the first feedback should be taken from the community people who are working into that since years and years. Like if you are starting with an embedded project, so in that case, you should refer to the committee people who are belonging to the electronics, who are belonging to embedded platform. Take insights from them, ask them whether your project is feasible, whether it will be able to scale in the market or not, how it is going to be. Because cost is also an important factor. So they will tell you that what are the different options which are available, wherein you can design the best product in less cost. So tapping into communities, referring your community people, and taking in more in-depth knowledge with respect to it. So that was your chapter, wherein we have seen that what do you mean by prototyping and what is it is as a process. Okay, so in the next lecture, we are going to start with the next chapter, which is your prototyping of your embedded devices. That's your chapter number 5. That's it for the day. Thank you.